Log Talk Radio.
Is it just me, or has the Miami Dolphins saga seemed to have been going on forever? Well, we're talking about everything but on Blog Talk Radio's Thursday Night Tailgate with your hosts, Chris Mascaro and Angelo Kane. Tonight, the fellas welcome for a second time former Packers and Giants defensive back Tom Flynn. A great friend of the show making his third visit with us, former Vikings and Chargers Pro Bowl guard Ed White. A guy we couldn't wait to have back right after an insightful visit last week, former Bills Pro Bowl linebacker darryl-talley back with us again this week. Making his third visit with us, former Bears fullback Jason McKee. And as always in his regular time slot, our good friend and New England sports columnist, Bob Lazzari, joins us. So as always, sit back, relax, and enjoy this No Hazing Zone show with a couple of good buddies of mine. Here's Chris and Angelo.
Hey, thank you, Joe Lodgenews. I love those intros he's coming up with. And yes, we are into day 10 of the Richie Incognito Jonathan Martin saga, and I can't promise you that we won't ask any of our guests about it, but what I can tell you is we won't be devoting segments of the show to it because, frankly, I'm sick of the topic. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Thursday Night Tailgate. A big shout-out to everyone listening on the Armed Forces Radio Network, Blog Talk Radio, iTunes, and any place else you're pulling us in. We're delighted you're here with us, and we have another great show in store for you tonight. I'm your host, Chris Mascaro, and it's going to be a fun night. To all the men and women who have served and are currently serving our country around the world, thank you for your service. Our world is a better place because of you, and our thanks to Sean Crost, Dennis Farrell, and all the folks at Armed Forces Radio Network. It's an honor to be a part of your network. You can find us and our show by going to armedforcesradionetwork.org and clicking on sports at the bottom of the page. You can also please give them a follow on Twitter, at TheAFRN, the Armed Forces Radio Network. Like I say, they're on Twitter. As Joe mentioned, all of our guests tonight are back for a second or third time. First up is going to be former Pitt, Packers, and Giants defensive back Tom Flynn. Tom was with us back in mid-September, and we didn't have enough time to get to his time with the Giants. So tonight we're going to call his segment the Giant Years, and we look forward to those stories here with Tom in just a few minutes. At the bottom of the hour, we will have our weekly segment with our great friend Bob Lazzari. We always enjoy and look forward to getting Bob's take on what's going on with the Jets, Giants, and Patriots. Then later this hour, former Pro Bowl guard with the Vikings and Chargers, plus one heck of an artist, Ed White, is going to be back with us. I'm sporting the Ed White jersey tonight in honor and out of respect for a great friend, a great guest, and like I say, we look forward to catching up with Ed here later this hour. We'll kick off the next hour with getting an immediate return visit from former Bills Pro Bowl linebacker darryl-talley. Last week, Darryl said he had a lot more he'd like to share. We wanted to give him the opportunity to do so. He's very passionate about some things going on around the league, and we wanted to give Darryl the opportunity to come right back and talk about those things. So we'll kick off the 9 o'clock hour with Darryl. Then we're going to wrap up the show, hopefully, with former Bears fullback Jason McKee. Now, we're not sure Jason's going to be able to make it tonight. He's going to do his best, so we're hoping he's going to join us to round out the show about 90 minutes from now. But before we get to any of that, let me bring in my co-host, Mr. Angelo Kane. Ange, how you feeling tonight, brother?
I'm feeling great. Another visit from Super Bowl Bills, and I'll take that.
Right.
So, and, yeah, I'm looking forward to it because I know that he really, if anybody follows darryl-talley on Twitter, they know that he just, like, goes crazy on game days and comments on what's going on in the league and all that. So it'll be fun to maybe step outside of the Super Bowl talk and just get some thoughts about what's happening these days and some of the stories and the headlines. So.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I talked to Darryl off the air, and he's passionate about a lot of things, got some really great stories to share, so we look forward to that. And having, gotten none of your boys from the mid-90s, right, now we get darryl-talley back-to-back weeks. We're going to have Eric Moles going to join us here next month, so hopefully we're making a crack in that dent of not getting any of that era of Bills on the show, and maybe we'll start getting a flood of them now for you.
Yeah, hopefully so. I mean, you got to hold on. You got to keep in contact, make sure you don't lose
That's right.
phone number. Let's keep it rolling.
That's right. All right, before we get into the heart of the show, as you get ready for your weekend tailgate parties, maybe you're tailgating tonight, getting ready to watch the Colts play, and hopefully we watch Andrew Luck throw three picks tonight to help me in my bet with Jeff Harrod and keep me away from having to wear skinny jeans and that sort of thing. So we're rooting for Andrew Luck to throw three picks tonight against the Titans. But as you get ready for your tailgate parties tonight, this weekend, what have you, remember to stock up on plenty of Kyven Foods salsas, sauces, and spices.
Add great flavor to your next tailgate party with Kyven salsas. Former NFL tight end Reggie Kelly created these salsas for dipping chips and much more. In hot and mild flavors, Kyven salsas make a great marinade. They are terrific in meatloaf and are super toppers for everything from baked potatoes to scrambled eggs. It's a great ingredient to enjoy in a variety of family favorite meals. And some people say Kyven salsa is a meal to itself. With all the possibilities, Kyven is truly salsa with soul. Kyven salsas are also made from natural ingredients, and they are preservative-free. So look for Kyven, that's K-Y-V-A-N, at area Walmart stores or online. Click on the Kyven logo on our website to check retail and online locations. More information at Kyven82.com.
Kyven Foods are brought to you by our friend and former Bengals and Falcons tight end, Reggie Kelly, who's going to be a guest with us here next week. Again, check out their wonderful array of products by going to Kyven82.com. Appreciate the goodness. A couple of announcements before we get into what's driving me nuts. If you haven't checked out the new CD, Skull Shaker, from former Saints, Rams, and Chiefs Pro Bowl tackle Kyle Turley, great friend of the show, go to iTunes or gridironrecords.com and add it to your music collection. If you like country music that really rocks, you're going to love this CD. The songs are awesome, and 100% of the downloads, the fee from the downloads, goes to support the Gridiron Greats Assistance Fund. So you get great music while supporting a great cause. It's a win-win, and we hope you'll check it out real soon. So, Ange, on to what's driving me nuts. And I gave you a little peek under the tent for what's driving me nuts. So you want to go first, or you want to let me rip?
No, I had my shot first last week, so go ahead and do your thing.
All right, you want to know what's driving me nuts this weekend? It's your Bills. That's right.
Hey.
Your Bills,
you got
crying about
Kelly
their schedule.
And this is how you start this show.
I'm telling you, and I told it, you know, said right to Darryl. Your boys crying about their schedule being unfair. Are you kidding me? And yesterday, your Bills president and CEO, Russ Brandon, said the Bills, you know, have contacted the league offices to complain about how unfair scheduling, namely the teams that they have played, have had an unfair amount of prep time to play the Bills. Now, he points out that both times, you know, they played the Jets, you know, those schedulers, you know, put them either after a long week when the Jets previously played a game on Thursday, thus allowing them a little more prep time, or the Jets this time are coming off a bye, right? Sunday's game will be the third time the Jets are playing a team coming off their bye week. The Bills are playing a team coming off their bye week. Previously, it happened in Week 7 against the Dolphins and Week 8 against the Saints. And guess what, Ange? You beat the Dolphins, so for crying out loud. And, you know, the Saints could have come off their game, you know, having played their previous game 30 minutes prior. You still wouldn't have beaten the Saints. So, you know, I'm not sure, you know, where this is all coming from and why we got to whine because, the 3-7 Bills, you know, are struggling. The reason why you're 3-7 has nothing to do with the fact that teams are getting more prep time. It has everything to do with guys named Thaddeus Lewis and Jeff Toole starting at quarterback. Heck, I expect, you know, Joe Ferguson or Jim Kelly to dust off their number 12s anytime now and suit up for you guys, you know. How about the fact that the Bills' defense is 22nd against the run and ranked 24th, giving up nearly 26 points a game? Perhaps that's the reason why the Bills are 3-7. You know, we never want the facts, right, to get in the way of a good whine, and whine being W-H-I-N-E, whine. But last season, teams coming off a Thursday night game were 16-18 and four times that team had, you know, didn't play all the way wrapping around to the Monday night game. And even then they were only 2-2. So really it's more of a disadvantage for the teams facing the Bills than it is for the Bills themselves. So, you know, stock down with the Bills whining about your schedule and you having to line up to play, you know, against teams that have more time. For crying out loud, let's play ball. Don't blame your 3-7 record on the schedule maker's hand. It's driving me nuts.
I think what you've done is basically taken this whole thing out of context.
Oh, is that right?
Yes, that's what isn't that what you're supposed to say when you know that's what's going on right now. In any story, you know, the story that we're going to try not to talk about, it was taken way out of context. That's
right.
All I'm saying. But I'm glad you did mention the whole quarterback thing, because that kind of will lead right into my quick what's driving me nuts before we jump on with our first guest. But, you know, in case you haven't read, the NFL will be looking at making quarterbacks safer. I don't know if you've ever done this before. But, yeah, so they're going to make the game safer. Now, if for some reason Jim Everett and Rusty Hilger are listening, you might want to cover your ears. But let me just go off on this a bit. I get it. I get that the game's got to be safer. But let's look at this thing a little bit. Before we start putting more bubbles around the quarterback, look at the position and how it's played now compared to a while ago. I mean, you got all these mobile quarterbacks. They're running out of the pocket. They're going to get hit. They have the ball so much more. You want to do, you know, you want to make this game a lot safer for the quarterback. How about you hand it off to that guy that's standing behind you once in a while? I mean, you know, this is, it's unbelievable. I mean, what else are we going to do? We already have adjusted the whole game to make, you know, it safer for them and safer for wide receivers and harder for everybody else.
Right.
You know, I mean, why not look at, what are they going to do? They're going to force everybody to hand up. This is just the nature of the game right now. Spread offenses, RG3s and Kaepernick's and Russell Wilson, all these guys, and even Andrew Luck and Ben, you know, well, he's got to run for his life these days anyways. But, I mean, these quarterbacks are just so much mobile and willing to run and be a part of the offense. You're not going to be able to protect them. I mean, other than putting a flag around their waist, once they're out of the pocket, that's it, man. They're open game. And, you know, I think that's really what they need to consider. I mean, it's just crazy. I know we've had a ton of quarterback injuries this season. I mean, God knows our Bills are been through the ringer. But, I mean, geez, come on, man. You've got to look at this thing, you know, for what it is. It's just a different game. And, you know, for them to make more rules to make the quarterback safer, that's just going to drive me crazy.
Yeah, no, I'm with you 100% with that. And Darryl Talley, I'm sure, will speak a lot of that when we have him on next hour. But so we'll save a little bit of that for then. All right, so we've got our first guest about to join us. But before we get to Tom Flynn, I want to give a shout-out to Renee Schell at Integrated Play. Check out what she's got going on at integratedplay.org. You won't find a better person to do business with anywhere. She's been a fantastic supporter of the show. She's doing some great things for some of our guests who are in transition from being pro athletes and are now going into the job market. She's the best. There just isn't another word and another way to describe her. If you work with her, it won't take you long to understand why we say that. If you're an athlete or anyone in the job market, do yourself a favor and reach out to Renee. You'll be glad you did. Check it out. Check her out at integratedplay.org online and give her a follow on Twitter at integratedplay. All right, so let's get on with our first guest. We've got Tom Flynn now joining us on the Kyven Foods guest line. Like I said, Tom joined us back in September, and we enjoyed the conversation so much we wanted to get him back on with us because there just wasn't enough time to get through everything we wanted to chat about. For those who weren't with us that night, let me give you some background on Tom. He was a fifth-round draft choice by the Green Bay Packers in 1984 out of the University of Pittsburgh, played from 84 to 88 with the Packers and the Giants. In his rookie season, he led the NFC in interceptions with 9 and was voted Pro Football Weekly's NFL Defensive Rookie of the Year. He's a member of the Giants' 1986 Super Bowl championship team. He scored 3 touchdowns in his career, all of which came on blocked punts. One, I'm guessing, had to be one of the most satisfying moments of his career, and we'll get to that in a minute. I became a fan of Tom's when he was a part of those great Pitt teams back in the early 80s, and we're thankful that he has made more time to join us tonight. Tom, how are you?
Very good. I'm having a little cold, and I hope I sound okay.
Well, we appreciate you playing hurt, Tom.
Thank you.
All right, so we talked last time about your time at Pitt, and we wanted to spend most of the time tonight focused on your years with the Giants. But before we get to that, I just wanted to get a few quick thoughts from you. Later tonight, Darryl-Talley is going to be back with us for a second time. He played at West Virginia while you were at Pitt. What do you remember about playing against Darryl in the backyard brawl and against West Virginia?
Well, that was between the West Virginia Pitt rivalry and the Pitt-Penn State rivalry. I mean, those two games were always circled on the calendar, and there was no doubt that what I remember most about West Virginia was the week of practice, especially when we played down in Morgantown. They would blare over the loudspeakers while we were practicing, the entire practice. John Denver's Take Me Home, Country Roads. Over and over and over, as loud as it could be, trying to simulate crowd noise.
Yeah.
But that's what their excuse was. But really, I think it was just to get everybody on edge and ready to play. But they were great games. Certainly, you know, we knew a lot of the players on the West Virginia team and on the Penn State teams. We'd either played with them or against them in high school. So it was a special rivalry. And, you know, it's just really sad to see it go away.
You mentioned that, right? You know, West Virginia goes away. You mentioned Penn State, Tom. You guys, you know, that was, you know, a super rivalry, you know, for, you know, my whole life growing up. You know, to that point, it was always about the Pitt-Penn State game. You know, being from Pittsburgh, you know, I had members of my family were, you know, Pitt fans, the other half were Penn State fans. That was a big deal. You're sorry to see, you know, look at the super conferences, and there's no more regional alignment, and it's more and more is going away every year. You're sorry to see those things break up?
Absolutely. It was it's just part of the, you know, now that I'm a fan, you know, my children, and I'm trying to make them Pitt fans, even though they've gone on to college and they'll have their own collegiate fan base. And I've got a couple that are pretty good Pitt fans, but the shame of it is that they've never had, you know, they're not going to get a chance to really experience some of the classic rivalries that the fan base enjoyed while back in the 80s and early 90s. And
right.
It is a shame to see that go.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with that more. All right, so last time, you know, we talked more about your time at Pitt and, you know, at Green Bay. So this time we wanted to focus on the Giant year. So let me set the stage for folks a little bit. Like I said, you were drafted by Green Bay, and you joined your Pitt teammate Tim Lewis there in their defensive backfield. Your very first game, you picked off Neil Lomax of the Cardinals. In Week 9, you picked off Gary Danielson of the Lions 3 times. You ended up leading the NFC in interceptions with 9. The following year, you had 1 interception, and in 86, Tim Lewis suffered a bad neck injury, which ended his playing career, and you were let go mid-season. So why did the Packers let you go, a guy who was arguably their best defensive player 2 seasons prior?
That's one of those perplexing questions that I try not to think about too often, but to give you a little bit of an idea of what was going on in Green Bay, he started that season 0-7.
Right.
And that, I think that had a lot to do with it. The other telling statistic is I was the 56th roster move of that season. So, you know, so when you fire a player and bring another player on, you know, that's two roster moves. But let's just say it was a revolving door at the front of the locker room. And every week there were, you know, two or three new guys, new faces in the locker room.
That's crazy. How do you have any continuity with something like that?
Well, you don't, and you know that's just a it's just poor management and you know, trying to use change as a substitute for as the illusion of progress, I guess is what I like to refer to it as. You know, as long as the Packers were making changes, they felt like they were doing something to better the team.
Change for change. There were some
you know, some really good football players that were let go that year, and it was a shame. But as it turned out, I have no complaints.
You ended up in a great situation in New York, but I wanted to get your thoughts on what, you know, getting cut by them. I believe was in October, and that was right before the upcoming November 2nd game against the Steelers in Pittsburgh. So I was curious to know how much you were looking forward to playing at Three Rivers, and did you have like family and friends that were planning on attending that game?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I went to the game, and you know, sat in the stands, and yeah, they were two pretty bad teams at that point. But I did get a chance to shout out at some of my former players towards the end of the game, or my former teammates at the end of the game, and I remember that moment, but. For the most part, yeah, it was disappointing. You know, kind of rubbing salt in the wound a little bit.
Yeah. So you mentioned last time you were here that Steelers owner Art Rooney had expressed some interest in you and thought that the Steelers should have drafted you. What would that have meant to you if you had the chance to wear the black and gold and have Three Rivers as your home field?
That would have been certainly a wonderful way to play professional football. I was happy just to have an opportunity to play. You know, Green Bay started out as a good situation. You know, my rookie year they were picking on me, so I felt like I was up to the task. The next year there were some injuries, but for the most part, a lot of dropped interceptions, and that was the difference between 9 and 1 interception. So that was unfortunate. It would have been great to be a Steeler. You know, when I had to try out in Pittsburgh, in 86, Art Rooney came out and watched my tryout, and and afterwards he came over to talk to me, and we had a nice conversation, and he said that told me that he had told his sons to draft me and coming out of college. And they didn't, obviously, and his comment was that, you know, he's an old man and no one listened to him anymore, so that was pretty funny. But certainly Tony Dungy was the coach that worked me out, and after I got done talking to our seniors, he came over to me and he said, you know, Art Rooney doesn't come out to watch, you know, free agents try out very often. So what is it that you have that, you know, that the others don't? And he said, well, I'm an Irish Catholic from Pittsburgh, so I think that pretty much says it all.
So you were picked up by the Giants after Thanksgiving. Describe the feeling of going from a team that was going through a total overhaul to one that was dominating the league at the time. The Giants were 12-2, and they were on a 7-game winning streak. And what were some of the differences that you noticed immediately from Green Bay when you joined the Giants?
Well, right away I noticed that, you know, the difference between a coaching staff that was well prepared and confident, that and players that were well prepared and confident with the Giants versus what I left in Green Bay, which, you know, everybody was on edge and looking over their shoulder to see if they were going to be the next person that was going to be cut. So that, you know, the whole atmosphere within the locker room was completely different. And for the most part, it reminded me of being back at Pitt and being in a locker room where, you know, when you step out onto the field, you were expecting that you were going to win. And that's what the Giants, that's what kind of mojo they had at the time. They just expected that we were going to win and went out and played like it.
So, Tom, the last regular season game that year just happened to be against the Packers. From the moment you got in the Giants locker room, were you excited to see that the Packers were on the schedule?
Well, I was just happy to be there, but certainly that last game, I thought, boy, this would be a great opportunity to, I was only playing on special teams, but I'm thinking to myself, this would be a good opportunity to, you know, show the Packers and the management that they had made a mistake, and I just didn't know how I was going to do it other than just playing as hard as I could and, you know, and letting the rest take care of itself.
Right.
So eventually we got into a situation on the punt block team and we had a punt block set up I was on the inside, and Lee Rousson was on the outside. And I was pulling the blocker in a little bit, and then Lee was taking an angle to the punter to try and block it. So we did that twice, and Lee came really close. After the second one, I went over to Romeo Cornell, who was the special teams coach, and I looked at him and said, Romeo, if you put me on the outside, I will block the punt.
And he,
because Lee was standing right there with me, and, you know, he was asking, you know, how, you know, we're close, you know, what do we need to do? I said, well, if you put me out there, I'll block it. So the next time they came out to punt, as it turned out, I was able to block it.
Most satisfying single play of your career?
Probably, yes. That and, you know, making the opening tackle in the Super Bowl on the kickoff. Now those two plays, I remember, you know, like they happened yesterday.
That's awesome. So that game against the Packers, you guys crushed them. You ended up crushing them 55-24. Did you know you were hoping to make an impression, and you did. Okay, you blocked the punt, scored a touchdown. You know, did anyone on the Packers say anything to you, whether it was the players or coaches or anyone say anything to you after the game?
They were all afraid to say anything. But absolutely. It's hard to imagine or hard to describe the kind of the fear that that the locker room had in Green Bay. It's just
really.
I can't describe it very well. Everyone was looking out for themselves, and there was not much of a team camaraderie because your best friend just got cut the week before, and now you're looking at your performance thinking, man, am I the next guy?
Right.
And the Giants were completely opposite. You know, the only time they made a roster move is if you were completely coming to the game unprepared or if you got hurt. And so, you know, once they set their roster at the beginning of the year, the other 2 years I was there, they very rarely made any roster moves.
I'm sorry. I didn't know. Finish up your thought.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, after that big win against the Packers, you followed that up by beating the 49ers and Redskins in the playoffs before you went on to the Super Bowl to face Elway and the Broncos. I mean, you got to experience playing for and against some of the most memorable NFL teams all within a span of a month. I mean, describe what that was, and then to experience the Super Bowl shortly after your exit from the Packers. What was going through your head?
And you're right. It was a fantastic run, and after making the play against Green Bay, that really helped my credibility in the locker room, which was took a lot of anxiety off of my shoulders too. So the guys, if they didn't know my name, they found out very quickly who I was. And you know, when you make a play like that, it really helps to show that you're going to be contributing to their success. And but then going out and playing the 49ers, and this is another play I remember, and I tell a lot of the people that I know now that the reason the Giants were so good is because they never gave up on a play. And the second play of the game, Jerry Rice catches a slant. excuse me. Sorry about that. I'm losing my voice here. So Jerry Rice catches a slant, and he is headed for a touchdown. And there's no one in front of him. And for some reason, he dropped the ball on the 5-yard line. Can't explain how it happened, but he just flat out dropped the ball. And on the film, by the time he stopped and turned around, there were seven Giants pouncing on the football. Seven guys were chasing him into the end zone.
Wow.
So that's the kind of football team that wins championships.
Right.
Whole different mentality.
Right. Well, Tom, thanks for coming back on the show tonight. Thanks for playing Hurts. I'm sure, it's not easy, talking to us for this long when you're not feeling very well. We appreciate that you made it.
I just need a little sip of water, but hey, thanks again for having me, and I appreciate the time to reminisce about my days.
We appreciate you being here. We hope you'll continue to come back from time to time, Tom, because we like having you on. We enjoy the conversation, and we'd love to get your insights on what's going on around the league currently as well.
All right. Well, thanks again, gentlemen. Have a great evening.
You too. The best to you and your family, Tom.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night. All right. Nice guy. I always enjoy our time with Tom, Ange.
Yeah, well, we had to get part two of the best side of his career. I mean, he started off great in Green Bay and then,
right,
unceremoniously let go, and then he goes on to win a Super Bowl. So that's a comeback for you right there.
Yeah, that's a great story. And, all the great days at Pitt, I love those as well. All right, so before we move on and get to our next guest, Bob Lazzari, we'll do a quick station break here.
Hi, this is Jim Everett, former Rams All-Pro quarterback, and you're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate with my buddies, Chris Mascaro and Angela Kane, right here on the Armed Forces Radio Network. Enjoy.
All right, now back.
Call me Angela.
I keep thinking that she called you Angela.
Caught that. I didn't pay attention. I got a phone call to make after this is over.
I keep hearing that. I keep saying to myself, he says Angela. Angela doesn't hear it, so it must not be.
Oh, no. I just caught that. He sucked that in.
Oh, that's beautiful. We'll keep playing that one. I might play it again here in a minute. All right, now back. Now for the best segment of our show every single week during the football season is our great friend, Bob Lazzari. Bob, how are things up in frosty eastern Connecticut?
They're doing okay, Chris. Let me just say that I don't know any Angelas that look like Angelo.
Yeah, so you caught that too, right? Did he say Angela? I think he did.
It was one of those things I couldn't really tell, Ange. That's why I just say Ange.
There you go.
One of the advantages. Yeah.
Well, it's funny because every time I talk to him, he says Ange. But on there, I think he slipped in Angela. I gotta have a talk with him. This is so wrong. He's laughing every week. I know he listens to that every week, and he's cracking up waiting for me to catch it.
That's beautiful. All right,
okay.
So, Bob, let's start this week by talking about my boys' Bills here. We got the 5-4 Jets at the whiny 3-7 Bills. The line is pick 'em, believe it or not, and the over-under set at 41. The Jets are 1-3 on the road. They're coming off a bye. The Bills are 2-3 at home. They're coming off a loss to the Steelers. How do you see it, Bob?
Yeah, very strange type of ugly game. Looks like it anyway, boys, as far as on paper. Jets are one of those teams, I think it's only happened once in history, guys, that they've alternated wins and losses since day one this year. This is supposed to be their week to lose. If you go win-loss, 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 win, there should be a loss. But, it's going to be tough for Buffalo when I read about Stevie Johnson being banged up. And, Jets do bring in Ed Reed here. Now, I think he'll play a little bit, guys. Probably put in here more for inspiring purposes than anything else. We know he played great for Rex Ryan when he was in Baltimore. Ivy running the ball, good for the Jets. Both quarterbacks, very similar. They're both going to make mistakes. It's almost like who makes the last mistake will lose the game, guys. But, man, I've been really racking my brain all week about this game. You know, both teams, lousy passing teams and then pretty good running teams. So it's it has everything on paper, guys, to be very ugly. And, of course, the Jets. I think the Jets' defense is just going to play just a tiny bit better, and they're going to break that alternating win-loss with actually and get two wins in a row. So, yeah, I'm going to say it's going to be something like a 23-20 game, guys. That's how I see it.
All right. And Jets offensive line, defensive line, both playing really well. They're ninth in the league in rushing yards per game at 129, and they're number one against the rush. For our fantasy football listeners, you know, bench Freddie Jackson and C.J. Spiller. Do yourselves a favor. They're not going very far against that Jets defense. But they're 28th in points scored per game, and just getting under, just a shade under 19 points per game. Can your boys generate enough offense to possibly sneak a win here?
I don't think this game is going to be about offense at all. This is going to be all about defense and, like Bob said, mistakes. I mean, you know, the biggest concern for the Bills is the fact that the Jets do lead the league in run defense. And, you know, you got Manuel, he's playing a second game back from the injury, and he wasn't sharp last week. You know, so the Bills really do have to rely on Jackson and Spiller. Third in the NFL, combination 141 yards a game, but that's going to be tough against these Jets. So that's really unfortunate. Then you also throw in those injuries that we have. So here's the way I look at it. You know, and also one other thing that you have to realize, too, is the Jets are getting Winslow and Santonio Holmes back. So we're losing guys. They're gaining guys. They're already playing strong on defense. The Bills' defense is second in the NFL in sacks, and Geno is tied for third in getting sacked. And the Bills are right up there, you know, with allowing sacks, too. So I think that's where this game is going to come down to. You know, neither offense is consistent or spectacular. So I think it all comes down to the battle in the trenches. And, you know, the trend has been win-loss, win-loss, win-loss. But you throw in a bye week there, and I think that's going to scramble them all up. So I'm thinking the streak ends. Both streaks are going to end. They're going to end that win-loss streak, and the Bills are going to end this three-game losing streak with the home crowd behind them. And
wow,
I think it's going to be low scoring. I'm thinking 16-14 Bills win.
Wow.
I'm going to be a homer.
You're a homer. There's no doubt. And I would expect nothing less. But I like the Jets in this one. Like I mentioned earlier, I mean, you games are won and lost in the trenches. Jets offensive line is pretty good. They're opening holes for the running game. Defensive line's outstanding. When your defensive line can stop the run and you make teams one dimensional, particularly when you've got a rookie quarterback back there or an inexperienced quarterback back there, you're going to win a lot of games. I like the Jets. I think they're going to do enough to win. I think you guys are both right. I think it's going to be a low-scoring game, but I like the Jets to win this game 17-10.
One more thing, Chris. The Jets have given up 62 points more than they've scored. That's almost impossible these days. Historically, it's almost impossible to be over 500 and do something like that. Just look at the NFL right now and teams that are like the Giants are just about the same, and they're, of course, 3-6, but that's amazing. And the other amazing thing is there's only one other team that's scored less touchdowns than the Jets, and I believe it's Jacksonville. So, again, ugly. It's going to be ugly, guys.
Right.
Well, here, let me throw
right.
one last thing in here, too. You know, the Jets, they've been impressive in the wins against the Patriots and the Saints, yet they've been very unimpressive in wins or in losses to the Steelers and then that loss to the Bengals. So, you know, do they play down to their opponents? If that's the case, 3-7 Bills, I mean, could be a loss.
You're just saying?
I'm just saying. I'm just hoping.
Indeed. All right, so next we have the 5-4 Packers going to MetLife Stadium to play the surging 3-6 Giants. Packers 2-2 on the road, Giants 2-2 at home. The Giants are a 5-point favorite, over-under set at 42. Bob, without Aaron Rodgers, can the Packers compete with the Giants who are, you know, again, amazingly now after losing the first six, they're on a three-game winning streak?
I think it's going to be very tough for the Packers to come into the Meadowlands and actually win again. It's The Giants are looking better, guys. It seems like their defense has gotten better each week. A rookie quarterback, Tolzien, going in there against it. A defense, again, that is improving. They're trying, again, Green Bay hasn't lost three games, I think, in about 5 years. I think the Giants are just going to have enough. Manning has not been impressive. His quarterback rating is down there. It was again last week. But I still say he's got those weapons. Nick, Cruz, they're going to put it together one of these weeks. I just don't think Green Bay is going to do enough offensively to win this game. Sad news about the Giants. David Wilson has been probably told that if he plays again, he's risking a lot health-wise. But Andre Brown, back, guys, from the broken leg, actually looked pretty decent last week. So maybe they can get that awful running game. It might be a whole new story now with him back there. So I see the Giants continuing the win streak. I see them winning maybe a 30-20 game, something like that.
All right. So, Ange, the Giants' defense continues to get better every week. Bob sort of alludes to that. They're up to 12th now in average yards per game allowed at just under 330. They're 11th. Against both the pass and the run, but their offense is ranked 30th in points per game, just a shade over 18. You would hardly guess that Eli is 10th in the league in passing yards because his quarterback rating is 30th at 68.5. Can they keep the winning streak going, or is this going to go the Packers' way?
No, I think it keeps going. You look at the Packers and they talk about some bad news going on there. I mean, you lose Aaron Rodgers, and they've lost two in a row and struggled against the Bears and the Eagles defenses, which are ranked 25th and 24th. And like Bob mentioned, the Giants defense has been heating up. They've carried the team the last three games. Here they're facing some guy who's playing in his second game. Defense has 8 sacks in the last 2 games, always a good stat. And also, I think their biggest concern is just making sure that Eddie Lacy and James Starks, don't get any momentum going. Andre Brown, welcome back. He looked really good. And Reuben Randall developing into a nice option for Manning. So, with all that going on, Giants are at home, getting more confidence with each win. So I'm looking at something around a 26-16 win for them and 4 in a row.
Wow. And, Bob, what did you have the score as?
Yeah, 30-20.
All right. I like the Giants as well. I agree with you guys. I think they're going to make it 4 in a row. Tolzien wasn't bad last week, for Green Bay. 24 out of 39 for 280 yards, a touchdown, a couple of picks. But banking on him, against an improving Giants defense seems pretty risky. Like you guys posted, Andre Brown back running well, 115 yards and a touchdown last week against the Eagles. I think the Giants are just going to sort of pound their way. I think it's going to be a close one. I don't think they're going to run away with this game. But I still think they get the win. I've got the score 24-20, so a little closer than both of you guys.
If anything does happen to the Packers quarterback, good news is they reunited with their old flame, Matt Swift. How about this guy traveling around the league? Wow. So they can always rely on memories to get them back, right?
Right, well, how great of a story would it be, really, for, Matt Flynn to find his way into the game and then, have another outstanding game for them, after sort of, to your point, coming full circle, having traveled for, God knows, 16, 18 teams in the last, year or so, to come all the way back to Green Bay and to have a great game. I'm sort of rooting for him to get in there to show what he can do, make a few teams sad that, either they didn't keep him or the system just wasn't right, but the Packers, it just might be. But I'm kind of rooting for that story.
Yeah, me too.
All right, so finally, before we get to our next guest who's hanging online, Ed White's with us. We'll get to him in just a second. Finally, the Monday night game, we have the 7-2 Patriots at the 6-3 Panthers. The Pats are 2-2 on the road. Panthers 3-1 at home. Carolina is actually favored by 2.5, over under 46.5. Pats have won 3 in a row. Panthers have won 5 in a row. Bob, Panthers number 2 overall on defense, and the Pats are coming off a bye, and they're 55-point output against my Steelers. Which one comes out on top? Strong defense,
yeah,
surging offense?
Yeah, without question, guys, the most fascinating game of the week, and we have to wait till Monday night to watch it. But Brady, 13-4 on Monday nights. It's got everything going for it. Like you said, they're coming off a bye. They're going to be as healthy as they were all season. We've been waiting for them to be healthy with Gronkowski, guys. You know, last time they played on Monday night against the Saints, I picked against them. You would think a team; these are the type of teams that give New England a lot of trouble. They're very, very good against the rush, obviously, and against the pass. Very, very, very talented defensive team. And the Patriots, just when you think they're going to come up against a tough challenge, they somehow get to it. But with Gronkowski back and Ridley, I'm not going to bet against them this time. I think the Patriots are going to win a close game. I don't think they're going to score is nothing like they did last time, that's for sure. But I think they can put up 28 to maybe Carolina's 24.
Wow. Okay. And New England's defense, 30th against the run, while the Panthers are 10th in the league running the ball. Can the Panthers ground it out against the pass?
That's what I'm looking for. You know, I mean, that's part of the Panther problem is their 29th-ranked passing game. I mean, Newton spreads the ball around a lot. You've got Steve Smith, Brandon LaFell, and Greg Olsen, and Ted King Jr., but none of them have been a breakaway threat this season. So, you know, they're going to have to rely on that running game, but they have been doing it just like the Giants have been lately, and that's just winning with defense. So, you know, I think that that's what it's going to come down to. And let's put this five-game winning streak in perspective for the Panthers. I mean, they've beaten the Vikings, the Rams, the Bucks, and the Falcons. The 49ers were their biggest test, and the only other test opponent they've had all season was the Seahawks, and they lost 7-12. So, you know, everybody ease up on this Panthers team. They're not as good as their record shows, and I think we're going to see that this week. I think it will be close, though, but I do think that the Panthers will pull out a close game at home from 23-20.
23-20. All right. So, you know, Panthers, you know, can only play the teams that are on the schedule, right? So you got to, you know, you got to play who's there, and you got to get those
right.
Wins. You can't play down to your, you know, to the team you're playing against. You can't play down to your opponent. So they've taken care of business and they've done what they've had to do. Now, you know, I like the Panthers. I think they are going to control the ball, keep it away from Tom Brady. I'm telling you, don't sleep on the Panthers. They're going to make it into the playoffs. I think this is a playoff bound team. I love their defense. I love their front seven, and I actually think they're going to win this game. I'm with you, Ang. Just slightly behind you. I think they win this game 20-17. It's going to be close, but it's going to be a lot of fun
to
watch.
Good point, Chris, is that they lead the NFL in time of possession, and that's what you want to do against a team like New England. Keep the ball out of Brady's hands. And if they can do that, they will. I'm just not going against Brady because they got burnt a few weeks ago.
Learned your lesson.
There, I did. Never again.
All right. So before we get to Ed White here, real quick, Bob. You know, Ange and I are big fans of your show, along with your co-host Tony D'Angelo, Monday Night Sports Talk, and that people can find on Channel 14 up in Eastern Connecticut, as well on your YouTube channel and at MondayNightSports.net. You've had a couple of friends of ours on the show recently. Who you guys got coming up?
I got another one coming up, J.J. Burden. We've talked to him, Chris, this past summer, and you can't get a better guy than J.J. Burden. Also have the Yale football coach Tony Reno, which during the week of the Harvard game, it's hard to get a guy like that, but he wants to come on and talk about the storied rivalry. That ought to be something. The game, of course, a week from Saturday. So be a lot of fun, guys, and I'm looking forward to talking to both guys, and it's always a pleasure talking to both of you guys.
Well, thank you, Bob. You know, you're always the best segment of our show. We can't thank you enough for being here week after week. You're the best, and we look forward to catching up with you again next Thursday, same time.
You enjoy the weekend and the games, guys. My regards.
All right, take care, Bob.
Good evening,
Thanks again.
Good night.
All right, so before we get to our next guest, Ed White, I want to get a word from one of our sponsors, Pictures Plus.
This segment of TNT is brought to you by the fine folks at Pictures Plus Incorporated. If you're looking to frame your sports memorabilia, artwork, pictures, or treasured memories, Get in touch with Tim Chisholm and the folks at Pictures Plus Incorporated, 678-468-0506. Tim specializes in top-quality framing, on-site design, speedy delivery nationwide, and local professional installation. Give Pictures Plus a call, 678-468-0506, or find him on the web, framedartexpert.com. For quality framing at an affordable price, it's Tim Chisholm and Pictures Plus.
That's right. Thanks to Tim and all the great guys over at Pictures Plus Incorporated. You can find their ad on our website, thursdaynighttailgate.com, right there on our homepage. Now joining us on the Kyven Foods guest line is the great Ed White. Ed, this is his third appearance with us. Not only was Ed a great player in the league, playing in the trenches at guard from 1969 all the way to 1985, he's also an amazing artist. Ed was a second-round draft choice by the Minnesota Vikings in 69 out of Cal Berkeley, where he was an All-American and named All-Pac-10 three times. He played for the Vikings from 1969 to 1977 and was one of 10 players to be a member of all four Vikings Super Bowl teams. Went on to play eight more years with the San Diego Chargers, was a four-time Pro Bowler, and is a member of more Hall of Fames than you can shake a stick at. The College Football Hall of Fame, University of California Hall of Fame, the Breitbart Hall of Fame, which honors people from San Diego. He's in the East-West Shrine Game Hall of Fame, the San Diego Chargers Hall of Fame, and by God, he should be a part of the Pro Football Hall of Fame, and we got to get that campaign started up again. I'm sitting here with my Ed White jersey on because I think the world of this guy, and in honor of him as well. Ed, how are you?
Hey, Chris. Doing good, Angelo. How are you doing, guys?
Doing good, Ed.
All right. Fantastic. Ed, you know, we've talked to you in the past, offensive line may be the most thankless job in the NFL. I've used the analogy on this show many times. My mother used to have a sign by the sink that said housework is a thing that you do that nobody notices until you don't, which I relate to offensive linemen, right? Nobody notices the job that the offensive line you guys do until either the quarterback gets sacked, the running back gets tackled behind the line. Do you think that's why great guards like you, we've had Jerry Kramer on the show, guys like you aren't in the Hall of Fame? Is that what it is?
Well, I think the focus is obviously on quarterbacks, receivers, and running backs. And, you know, you have to really be want to watch an offensive lineman to really study what he does. And so I do think that we probably don't get as looked at, you know, by the general public as a lot of people.
Right. So we talked last time a little bit about your relationship with another one of our favorite guests, Kyle Turley. Since Kyle has come out and talked about his physical and psychological struggles, Tony Dorsett now is talking about his memory loss and his emotional swings, if you will, is the, you know, the $765 million settlement, the things that the NFL has done to, you know, to help treat, you know, players nowadays and to help, you know, guys from your generation on up through the most recent. Is it enough? Is it enough that they've taken care of, you know, all these issues facing players with the brain trauma and whatnot?
Well, I think it's kind of like Obamacare. It sort of remains to be seen if it's going to work, you know. I don't see how players are going to get anything from this. I'm hoping they do, and there's certainly a need to take care of guys. I mean, I played with guys that were on less than $10,000 a year when I first started, guys that had been in the league for 10 years. And certainly, you know, they didn't accumulate enough money to take care of some of these astronomical pools that these guys are coming with. And there's more and more players that I talked to. I talked to guys that had some form of dementia, Mick Tinglehoff and Jim Lindsay that I played with the Vikings, that, you know, already at a point where they're needing a lot of help. And hopefully it will work. But unfortunately, it sounds good, but it remains to be seen how and who's going to be in charge of it, who's going to be distributing it, and what kind of information. I mean, you know, so there's a lot that remains to be seen.
Right. We had one of your line mates on the show a couple of months ago, Ron Yeri. He was very humble about what it took to, you know, to be a tackle in your offense. He said all you had to do was block one of four guys. How easy could that be? All I had to do was either block the defensive end, the defensive tackle, the outside linebacker, or the inside linebacker. Easy. Couldn't have been that easy, was it?
Well, when we first started, Ron is simplifying it a bit, but there was pretty much a 4-3 defense. And you know, we played, the guards were covered and the tackles were covered pretty much most of the time. And every once in a while they'd throw a new wrinkle at you. But, you know, now football's a little different deal. You know, Bud and the boys used to go home after dinner, and that was the way he did it. And now they stay up all night.
Figure out things to do and ways to confuse people. So it's a little bit different game.
Sure is. Speaking of a different game, in preparing for the game, I read that you didn't really do any weightlifting until the second half of your career when you were with the Chargers. Then you played racquetball to get in shape, and you know, you didn't see the carryover from the weight room to the field, and I'm wondering, I mean, you see these guys today with all the injuries and the hamstrings and the groins. I mean, do you think that's kind of showing what you were thinking back then?
Well, Angelo, actually, we didn't even have a weight room when I first went to Minnesota. Bud Grant made this comment many times that he didn't see the carryover from the weight room to the field in terms of the movements that happened on the football field. And I think to a certain extent he was right. I mean, you know, pretty much the weights were very basic, free weight. You know, you did a certain regimen of things from bench press to squats to blah, blah, blah. And it was just sort of coming into vogue. Well, what happened was the players started making more money. We, of course, had to work in the off seasons to support our families. And so we all had two jobs. Some of the older guys had a job during the football season. I mean, that's when they came in, they had to with their salaries. Now, these guys have, it's all about football year round. And so their diets, their weightlifting, I mean, they're stealth bombers. They really are. It's just amazing to watch them fly around and hit each other. And so I think they just have more time to spend in the weight room. Weightlifting, I mean, somebody told me that it was Ron, I think, was telling me there were 6 strength coaches with the Vikings, and that they have to get guys through there so fast because the Players Association has a very strict guidelines as to how many hours they can be in the facility. I think it's 6 hours, Ron said. I'm not sure about all this, but that's what Ron said. He's pretty astute about that stuff. And so they're, you know, at 6, we didn't even have a bar to do anything much when we were there. And it took us through, you know, in 8 years or 9 years, Minnesota, I think, was on a championship team, 8 of the 9 years. So it worked, you know.
Well. So, you know, Chris mentioned Jerry Kramer being on the show, and he played in the famous Ice Bowl game, but you also played in a memorable cold game, the 1981 AFC Championship in Cincinnati, known as the Freezer Bowl game, the coldest game in terms of wind chill, which was minus 59. Take us back to that game and tell us what it's like trying to play in those conditions.
Well, I, of course, coming from 9 years in Minnesota, went out for warm-ups with just, my shirt, sleeves on, and I was the first guy in the locker room to get dressed up and learn. And so the game should have been canceled. It was a dangerous situation. We had several guys with frostbite, including bounce at the end of the day. But the winds, what has happened is Mr. Brown, being the most powerful kid in football, opened the tunnel in that whole stadium to create a draft. And when we had the ball, we were going into the wind. We couldn't hit the broadside of a barn. It was impossible. Plus, you couldn't hold the ball. It was absolutely the game should have been played in Houston, and he put the brakes on that and said, no, we're not going to go down there, but we're playing here. And unfortunately, that was one of the best teams I ever played on, and talent-wise, on both sides of the ball that year, and that was a shame. And then coming into that thing from the Miami game, which was the total opposite, 110 degrees, and we played five quarters of football or something ridiculous. And that was the, you know, considered one of the all-time great games to it. One of the all-time cool games back-to-back was pretty tough for us.
Yeah, absolutely. Right before this game, there was an outstanding playoff game between your Chargers and the Dolphins in Miami, known as the Epic in Miami. Not only was it an unbelievable game of comebacks and lead changes and plenty of scoring, but it was a game made famous by Kellen Winslow. I think most NFL fans have seen the highlights and the ending where Winslow is being helped off the field. I mean, give us some memories and thoughts from that game.
Well, my biggest memory was when here I was 4 years old and Kevin was like 19, you know, he expended himself, no question. But we're in the locker room kind of going, shoosh. And so I'm next to Louis Kelcher, and a reporter is interviewing both of us. He starts with Louis. He goes, Louis, how did that feel? And Louis goes, well, it felt like I just rode a horse all the way from California to Miami and back. And he turned to me right away, and he said, Ed, how do you feel? I said, I feel like the horse Louis rode. I think that was my best football quote.
So, Ed, you blocked for one of the best scrambling quarterbacks of all time in Fran Tarkenton. I compare Fran a bit to, you know, the quarterback of my team, you know, Ben Roethlisberger a bit. People always scream at Ben to get rid of the ball. Goodness knows my father and I do it on a regular basis on Sundays. When Fran was back there running around, was it hard having to block and keep, sort of keep an eye on him and like, where the heck is Fran and who am I blocking here? And
no, you know what? Not at all. He was a pleasure to block for, a great athlete, and a very brilliant mind. And I was very, very lucky as an athlete. I never talked about this to play next to the greatest people. Ron, you interviewed Russ Washington when I came out to San Diego. Nick Kinglehoff at center and Donnie Masek, all pro guys. So you could. It makes things a little easier for you when you play 17 years between four guys like that. And so I was very fortunate and felt good about that entire experience. And Tarkenton was one of those good guys, one of those great guys that, you know, it wasn't as exasperating as it sometimes felt not knowing where he was at, because if he wasn't where he was supposed to be in the pocket, then you probably got beat by somebody in. And you're well aware that he's not going to be there.
So speaking of which, you know, guys you played along with, you know, every day in practice you went up against four of the best defensive linemen in the history of the game, and Jim Marshall and Alan Page, Carl Eller, Gary Larson. Was it easier on Sunday than it was trying to deal with those four guys during the week in practice?
Absolutely. And that a lot of people never got that as part of the deal, but after I got done practicing, and I had Alan Page, and Alan, you know, was a very hard worker, and like myself, you know, just gave everything he had every play in practice and in the games. And, you know, when you face that every day on Sunday, it's usually a step down.
Right. Imagine it was.
Yeah.
So you went from playing for Bud Grant to Don Coryell, who was heavily favored, the passing game over the running game. Was that a big adjustment for you to go from, you know, one system to the other like that?
Not really. You know, I enjoyed pass blocking as much as I did run blocking, and so I really, in fact, I enjoyed pass blocking a little more than run blocking.
Is that right?
Because I think it's more of an art to it. It's more of a dance, you know. Run blocking, a lot of it is will and you talk to Ranieri, he's one of the greatest run blockers I've ever seen. I mean, just extremely, could just move people out of there. I don't think I had the ability to move people out of there like
Rhonda, I don't know if it was his back strength or what, but it was just off the charts. And, you know, there's just some guys. John Hanna is a guy, you know, stripes. There's no, I mean, he was unbelievable run blocker. Didn't pass block so well, you know. And so there's, you know, that's what's interesting about watching offensive linemen.
So last time you told us a great story about Joe Green. You told the one where Joe, you know, took a screwdriver on the field after someone said something off color to him. So in trying to avoid this topic, I got to ask you your thoughts on this because of the off-color stuff that's been, you know, said down in Miami by Incognito. I just want to get your thoughts on that whole thing and, leaking all this stuff out before, you know, we could really get an idea of what was going on.
First of all, is that his real name?
No, I'm sorry.
Is that his real name?
We don't know. We don't know. Maybe not.
That's what I wanted to start with. But, you know, I'm glad you asked that because it is interesting. I think that rookies are in a vulnerable position, and they are taken advantage of on a lot of teams, and have been for years. I'll give you the story. I was the only rookie to make the Minnesota Vikings team. They kept about one rookie every year for about 10 years, and that's nucleus you kept together. And so being the only rookie, the rookies had to buy donuts every day, and they had to buy a birthday cake every day that was your guy's birthday. So I call it financial hazing because I was earning less than 20 a year at that point. And so my wife's laughing right now. $50 a day. $50 a day for donuts. And then the cake, when I had to get a cake, was a little pricey. Now, when I was coaching for the Rams, it's the step up considerably. They have the young guys go out and buy sandwiches for them and stuff like that. I never saw or have never been around any physical hazing. This one doesn't sound right to me. You know, I think there's more to it. But I don't think guys are so much into that. I think they're about having fun, having a rookie show with rookies singing and, you know, entertaining. That I've been around that, but not anything like this apparently sounded like.
So, Ed, before we let you run, we've got our next guest, Darryl-talley, waiting on the line for us. Your website is edwhiteart.com. A percentage of your profits go to support the Oak Lake Art Center in Julian, California, to help young people tap into their artistic side. Just remind people about what you're doing with that and some of the latest paintings you've got coming.
Yeah. Well, I've kind of taken a little detour into the abstract world, and so I'm doing some abstract stuff now, which I'm really enjoying. I love working with kids, and I've got a foundation that has graciously donated some iPads for the program, and I've been doing some electronic art and doing some pretty amazing stuff on the computer that I'm going to start teaching in the elementary schools to the kids, and I won't have to haul in all my paints and brushes all the time, so I can bring in 10 or 15 computers and get a class and do something that they can take on and use in whatever way they can, because it's a very neat program to learn how to do graphics with the computer.
That's fantastic. Ed, thank you so much for joining us again tonight.
Right,
You've become one of our favorite guests and one of our favorite people on the planet. We hope you'll continue to come back and join us from time to time because we'd love talking with you.
Well, thank you. My name is Mitchell, and good luck to you guys.
All right.
Thanks, Ed.
All the best to you and your family, Ed. Thanks again. Good night. One of the great ones, Ange.
Yep. Should be in the Hall of Fame.
Yes, he should. There's no question about that at all. All right. We'll get to our next guest, Darryl-talley, right after this station break.
You're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate with Chris Mascaro and Angelo Kane,
Armed Forces Radio Network.
All right, now joining us on the Kyven Foods guest line is Darryl Talley. We had so much fun talking to Darryl last week, and he was so passionate about some of the issues that he's seeing around the league that we wanted to have him right back on the show. And here he is. Darryl, thanks so much for taking time again tonight to be with us.
Oh, no problem at all, Chris. How are you guys doing?
Oh, we're fantastic. Thank you. So you and I were talking off the air, and you mentioned a number of things going on around the game today that's driving you crazy, one of which is how handicapped defenses are now due to the rules changes, you know, that are so, you know, drastically impacting what defensive players can do, barely able to touch guys, it seems like, at times. Share your thoughts on the rules changes that you're seeing around the league.
Well, the rules that I see changing right now, I understand everybody wants to see offensive scoring and stuff like that because everybody loves to see people score. But nobody wants to see anybody play a good defensive football game. Some of the rules that are in place right now, they don't allow guys to play football. They might as well put them in cheerleading skirts and start giving them pom-poms to play it. Serious. I mean, they just stand on the sideline and cheer because they're not allowed to hit a guy. I mean, when you see a defensive back try and tackle a quarterback, he hits a quarterback low. Buffalo lost their quarterback for what, 8 weeks, 6.5 weeks?
Right.
Because a guy hit the quarterback low. Normally, a guy hitting the quarterback's going to try to hit him up top. This week rattles his cage and let him know, hey, we're out here all day. Now the guy leaves, the guy goes back to the huddle thinking, in the back of his head the whole game, that I got this guy out here that's trying to tear my head off. I better stay in the pocket and throw the ball down the field. Well, if he gets out of the pocket and runs, he gets hit low once, he's out of the game, that's it, bring a new guy in. No continuity.
Right.
There's just so many different things that are going on in the game right now. They're not allowing people to tackle. I understand why they did what they did. Because a couple years ago, I called it human bowling, where guys would be playing defense, and all he would be doing was hurling themselves at people, trying to knock them down like bowling pins. Well,
yeah.
My thoughts were, what if those guys had to try and tackle people with the likes of Barry Sanders, Eric Dickerson, Walter Payton? If they had to try and tackle them, you couldn't just run into them and knock them down. You had to grab them and grab cloth and bring them to the ground. Guys don't do that anymore. That's a lost art. That's something that nobody's being taught. And right now, when you really look at the game, you're watching basically an offensive game. Everybody wants to see the points scored. Everybody wants to see people get hit, but they don't want to know about the repercussions. So, you know, it's a double-edged sword, but it's a real slippery slope, and I just look at it, and there's a lot of things that I see going on in the game that I don't understand. I don't understand why technique's not being taught any more than what it's been.
Let me ask you. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
I was just going to jump in and ask you this. I mean, doesn't this all lead back to the NFL? I mean, they were the ones that were promoting the bone-jarring hits repeatedly on videos and highlights. And then younger players think that this is the road to stardom, and therefore they forget the fundamentals and just look to make that highlight instead of playing a complete game. I mean, is it that the kids don't care about the fundamentals or that they're not getting taught?
Right.
I don't know if they don't care about the fundamentals or if they've not been taught the fundamentals. Because basically, I agree with you because everybody was playing for the Sports Center highlight shot. They didn't care about making that grueling, hard, devastating hit. Whereas it doesn't look real flashy, but it hurts like the dickens. You know, they didn't care about that. All they wanted to do was be on Sports Center because that's how everybody was being paid by the highlights they showed.
Right.
If you got shown on the highlights, then you got a bigger contract, okay? But for playing a very solid football game, playing it by X's and O's and doing it the right way, you weren't being paid for that. You were only being paid for the highlight shots that were being shown. So, of course, everybody's going after the glitz and glamour. That's what they did. But, you know, I understand that. But my problem is being a purist. and being somebody that is a technician and understands the game very, very well, I don't get it. Because I'm like, you lose half of what the game's about. Because right now you're just throwing it, as my dad would say, up a wild dog's butt. Because right now it doesn't make a lot of sense what you're doing, but you're just doing it. And
so,
it just doesn't set well with me.
So are the rules changes making the game safer at all in your mind, Darryl?
I don't think the rule changes aren't making the game any safer. I'm going to be honest with you. Because here's the thing. What they're doing is, okay, guys say, well, if you don't hit a guy in the head, he doesn't have a concussion problem. He doesn't have this problem or that. But if you hit the guy where they're allowing you to hit him at, what it's going to do is it's going to do what I said at the beginning of the year. It's going to create more lower leg injuries. It's going to create more career-ending injuries, more back injuries, more ankles, more feet, everything. Because right now, a guy has nowhere else to hit you except for low.
Right.
And if somebody's got you held up and somebody hits you low, what's that going to do? That's going to tear your pins out. It's going to tear your legs up. And guess what? You make your living with your legs.
Right.
Is it what a guy wants to do? No, it's not what a guy wants to do, but it's the only alternative that the league has left him. I mean, because
yeah,
if they hit anybody head-to-head, if they hit anybody face-to-face, that's considered head-to-head. I've got a question about that. If I want to hit you head-to-head, you want to call head-to-head contact, how is it that a running back or wide receiver can catch the ball, run, lower his head to run into the defensive player, and it not be called head-to-head contact, but if a defensive player is going to hit an offensive player and the offensive player jumps up and ducks his head, that's called head-to-head contact.
Right.
How are you supposed to make a tackle? Number one. That's why I said put them on pom poms. Give them all pom poms.
Yeah. And they're expecting these guys to make those adjustments in like milliseconds. You know, somehow. You know, I mean, you know, me and Chris joke about this all the time. I mean, the head is connected to the shoulder by a few inches. How are you not going to make contact with the head?
You're not. And that's the point. I don't think they get. They say they're trying. Look, the NFL, let's put it this. Let's put it the way it is. The NFL never really got worried about head injuries or anything like that until the whole thing came up about what was happening with older players. The NFL really never gave 2 cents about it. They never thought about it. They never cared about it. It was never on their radar. The rules wouldn't have changed if people had said, look, this is what's happening to these guys. They're running into dementia. They're forgetting where they're at. Well, guess what? That happens to a lot of people doing that, playing that game. But guess what? It's a part of it. And as soon as they decide that they're going to realize and embrace it, that it is part of it, it is part of what they should be paying for with $900 billion that they get a year. Well, as soon as they realize that and start to put money towards that, then maybe it'll change. But trying to change the rules and the way a guy plays, so basically you don't want anybody to play defense. You just want everybody to play offense. And you want everybody to come out and cheer for the offense, but nobody to cheer for the defense. That's kind of one-sided. I mean, you think about it. I mean, they're asking people to do things and spend their money in a crazy manner and way, which I'm sitting there going to myself, going, wait a minute. Have they lost their mind? I understand they're trying to make it better. They're trying to make it safer. But they're not. They're actually making it worse because if a guy doesn't play the game at full speed, he's more inclined to get hurt. Because he's not going full speed.
Right.
The only time you really get hurt, in my opinion, is when you don't go full speed or when you get hit by friendly fire.
at your own teammate. Yeah, I've been hit by friendly fire, and I've been hurt by friendly fire, which is where most of my injuries came from.
So one of the other things,
me hitting somebody.
One of the other things, Darryl, we were talking about is, you know, you talk about the lost art of tackling. We also talk about whatever happened to defensive backs, you know, getting up close and doing, you know, a bump and run against wide receivers and tight ends. You know, my father, what drives my father nuts when we're watching a game is that defenses allow tight ends to have a free release, you know, off the line of scrimmage, guys like Rob Gronkowski and all those guys getting a free release. What's going on there? Why do they not hit the tight end and the wide receivers?
A year ago, I was in Buffalo, and I asked the coach that. I said, I can't understand it. Why is that guy not touching him? We can't teach younger guys to do that.
What?
They can't do that. Young guys can't do that. I stood there and I looked at the guy.
Bump and run?
No.
Understand what I'm saying. When I asked the coach that, the coach looked at me and he says, we can't teach young guys to do that. And I'm thinking to myself, I did this for 14 years. Every day, I could hit the tight end, pick up the back coming out of the backfield, and be able to cover it. Now, what is wrong with being able to hit the tight end and be able to pick the back up and cover him in man-to-man coverage? I don't understand. I don't get it. How come you can't teach that? Well, the reason why they can't teach it is they're backing off of everybody at the line of scrimmage. So it's no wonder the passing yards are out the roof. It's no wonder that people will fly by Andre Reed. They're going to fly by the Chris Carters. They're going to fly by everybody with receiving yards, because guess what? There's no putting of your hands on the offensive guys. You still have 5 yards once you touch the man. That part didn't change.
Right.
Not yet. But they don't do it. No, but very few teams do it. Every now and then, most of the teams you'll see do it will be the Patriots and Jets. They will put their hands on the guy. But my question is this. If you don't put your hands on him, how are you going to slow him down? So everybody gets a free release. I mean, you got Gronkowski running down the field, 6'6", 6'7", 260 pounds. Probably has about a 30-inch vertical jump. Okay, and the most defensive backs are 6'1" to 6'2", probably with a 38-inch vertical, maybe a 40. Well, guess what? He still can't jump as high as Gronkowski, and he's not strong enough to body up against him.
Right.
Most linebackers don't jump that high or can't run that well. So, you know, and that's the other thing. The size of the players has virtually stayed about the same, in my opinion. The only people that have gotten faster have been the linemen, the offensive and defensive linemen. The receivers are still about the same. The linebackers still about the same. Quarterbacks have gotten faster. I will say that. Quarterbacks and offensive and defensive linemen have gotten faster. Bigger, yes, to some point when you look at the Cam Newtons out there and the RG3s. Okay, but the rest of it, football is still football. It's still mano a mano. It's man on man. And everybody's trying to beat people with schemes.
Right. You know, quarterbacks getting faster is a big problem for the NFL. Because we talked about this at the top of the show, that now they're going to look at further ways to protect them. And my comment is, these guys are running out of the pocket. They're spread offenses. They're becoming more a part of the running game. What else do you got to do now?
They are a part of the running game. Once they leave the tackle box, they're fair game. And the thing that kills me is that they're allowed to run straight up and down. And then, when they see you coming at them, they're allowed to try and give a half-ass fly.
Yeah.
Now, if I'm coming at you full bore and you half fly, you're just going to be missing the top half of your body because I'm going to take that with me.
Yeah, and Michael Vick knows all about that, but he still hasn't learned how to fly right.
Well, see, that's the thing. They want guys to make plays with their legs, but they don't want them to suffer the consequences because quarterbacks truly and are an integral part of your offense. And if you take, if you cut, it's like cutting the head off a snake. If you cut the head off, the body will eventually die. So you can eventually beat somebody if you knock the quarterback out of the game. Unless they do what they're doing now because of what they've done, what they've done with the running backs, and that's do it by platooning guys. They don't just have one running back play. They have two backs or three backs that'll play. Okay, so therefore they don't get guys beat up too bad, and guys are able to last a little longer, they say. I don't know. I think the jury's still out on that one. I still like the idea of having my Barry Sanders back there to hand the ball to, my Thurman Thomas to give it to, and to throw it to, and to bring my Kenny Davis in every now and then for an off shot. Yeah, I get that. But what they're doing, I don't know.
When you're watching linebackers and you're watching their technique, you talk about, you know, not being good tacklers and really kind of going for the Sports Center highlight moment. When you're watching linebacker technique, are they, aside from the tackling piece, is technique the same? Are they approaching the game the same, or is just the whole thing off?
The whole thing's off, because here's the thing. When I watch most linebackers play right now, there's no read step. The first step, they're often running. What happens when it goes to a counter? Oh, that's somebody else's play. Somebody else got to be over there to make that. That's true. But if you're a true linebacker and you're running, you take that first step, then you can redirect. But a lot of them don't take a read step. A lot of them are just often on their merry little way running because the way defense, some of the defenses that I've looked at have been designed is that they're designed to, whereas they don't touch one of the inside line. If they're playing a 4-3, the inside linebacker is not to be touched. The first person that he's going to see is going to be the ball carrier. So he's got a free run to the ball. If he makes a mistake on his read, he's going to be behind. He'll make him tackle from behind. But if he just so happens to guess right and gets everything right, he'll be able to hit the running back in the backfield because there's not going to be anybody to touch him when they're playing the 4-3, they're playing 4-3s and even fronts the way they're playing them right now. There's no one to block them. There's no one there. The center can't get off because you got a 1 and a 3. Those are your defensive tackles. They're in the gaps on either side. So they're the people that are there to absorb all of these guys. It's not like playing an odd front or even a true leading front where somebody's got to either slip or scoop to get you. So they try and do it, and what they call themselves getting to the second level, basically all they're doing is getting the defensive line turned a little and then trying to run up the field. They're not hitting them. They're just making a linebacker run the hump. So, you know, it's really a skewed thing to watch a linebacker play. There's no guys that are coming up taking on people. Very few linebackers take on guards anymore.
So to that end,
what you don't like.
One of the things that, you know, we talked a little bit about, Darryl, is one of our good friends and the guy we love on the show is Jeff Harrod. Used to play for the Colts, was one of your contemporaries. He always talks about the warrior mentality. Do you see that still alive in the game, or has that changed too?
Oh, that's changed. That's dead. Because if a guy gets a hangnail, he's done. I'm serious. He gets a hangnail, he's done. That's it. I mean, he's going to talk to the trainer. He's not doing anything else. He may get hurt. He can't play anymore. That'll be it. Well, let me think about this. Back in 1990, I had three surgeries at once, elbows and one knee at one time. Then, right before the season started, on Monday, I had surgery on my knee to take a piece out, and I banged up and played on Sunday. Made all pro.
Wow.
Never missed a beat. Would that happen today? No. People, they don't know what it's like to play with pain. They think because they get a couple of bumps and bruises that they're sore, they hurt. No. You want to be sore and hurt? You try being 230 pounds, playing against a 350-pound guy every snap, and then having to go chase a wide receiver or go chase a running back out of the backfield, and then have to do that down after down every day.
Wow, that's amazing.
Then you tell me what's sore and what's tired and what hurts and what doesn't.
Right.
I don't think you can. And that's why I say most of the inside linebackers today don't take on guards. I'm serious. If you watch a game, watch how many times you see the inside linebackers, and everybody's basically playing a nickel front or a nickel defense. And sometimes when you see people playing a nickel front, or if they play a 3-4 front, then you'll see the linebackers adjust and they'll move. They'll move in different spots. But mostly, they're a nickel front, and you hardly ever see those two linebackers take anybody on. The only person they're going to take on, one linebacker will take on the lead back, and the other guy's always going to be free runner to hit the fullback. Every time you see somebody, or the guy with the ball. The guy with the ball is always, the linebacker, if you're playing a 4-3, the guy in the middle has always got a free shot at the ball carrier. It's just funny to me.
So you talk about your surgery, and you never missed a game while you were playing for the Bills. Did you ever hide any injury from the team?
Yeah, what?
Did you ever hide an injury from the team and not tell them just so you could stay on the field?
No. Well, when I got hurt, I told them I was hurt, but my thing was this. When I played in the league, it was like this. If you didn't play each and every week, if you left, it's an old adage, if you leave your glove on the field, somebody will pick it up and start to play with it, and you'll never get a chance to play with it again. When I played in the NFL, if you didn't play, you couldn't make the club in the tub, and if you did not play, if you didn't play, then guess what? That was it. You're done. You're gone. They got rid of you.
Wow.
There was no and if buts about it. I mean, if you weren't out there on Saturday or Sunday when it came time to play the game, that was it. The next week, you're out of there.
Wow.
I played in Buffalo one year where every other game in 85 or 86, every other game I had a different corner playing behind me. For 16 games.
Right.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, that's tough.
And, it didn't matter if the guy was supposed to play. He was hurt. Okay, he was hurt. You cut him and get a new one.
Yeah. So you've told us. You've told us what you don't like about the game, but are there guys out there that you enjoy tuning in to watch play on Sundays?
Oh, I love watching the two guys from San Francisco play, the two linebackers there, Bowman and what's the young one? Went to Mississippi. God, I can't think what his name is. I know it as well as my own.
I'll get it for you. Keep going.
Well, I enjoy watching two of them play because they actually get after people. They actually run. They play the whole game. They're still products of the system, but they don't have to take on blocks, but they do. There's a lot of times when they're allowed to slip blocks, and the way the system's set up for them. And they do have a great outside linebacker, in my opinion, and that's the guy Brooks. Because he takes up a lot of the slack that nobody else sees. And I just watch, and it's really fun to watch them play. Who else?
You're talking about Patrick Willis earlier? Is that
Willis?
Patrick Willis.
Yeah, Willis.
That's it. God, I couldn't get that out. And I ought to be beat for that one. He deserves to beat me for that one because I couldn't remember his name. But, you know, I like watching those guys play. I like watching people that get after people and they stay after them. They don't quit. So, you know, there's a lot of people in the game that, in my opinion, I think quit. So, you know,
well,
I don't.
You got to like Kiko in Buffalo, right?
I like the way the kid plays, but like I said, he's young yet, he's making plays, and guess what? That's what he needs to do. And right now on the defense that they're playing, he's allowed to be a free hitter, and he should be the one making the majority of the plays around there. He's the type of linebacker that can get into space and play in space. Some guys can't play in space, and some guys can't. Some guys, when they get out in open air, they don't know what they're doing. Other guys, when they get out in open air, say, okay, I understand where I'm going. I understand where he's going. I know where he's going. So I'm going to go right here to the middle intersection and stop because he's coming to me and he's going to come to me. And that's what Tico Alonso's been doing. He's a student of the game.
Right.
You can't take that away from the kid.
Darryl, last week you mentioned that coaches did worse things to you than what's going on right now between Richie Incognito and Jonathan Martin. What are some of the examples of things you had to deal with?
I had a coach look at me and tell me, he said, do you not understand? They called it deucing. They wanted you me to cover, and that was back when they were running two tight end offenses. The guy wanted me to cover the tight end on the other side of the field, and I'm on one side of the field, and he wanted me to cover him with an inside linebacker. We were playing a 3-4 defense. And I'm going, this isn't making sense. If I'm on top of the guy and I push him down into the defensive end and I'm holding him right there, why does he have to wait? Or if the guy runs out or he doesn't come to my side, what am I going to do? Well, then you just drop back to the hole and sit in the middle of the field. I kept looking at him, and I go, no, that doesn't make sense. He said, just do what I tell you to do and don't say nothing else. I said, okay. I just looked at him and shook my head. That's what I could do. I've had one coach that was, I don't know if you want to say, I don't know. I don't know if he was racist or he didn't like me because of the young lady I was dating that was my wife. Called my parents on me about him. He called my parents about me dating my wife and told my dad, I'm not giving my football an opportunity because I'm busy chasing this young lady. And my old man told him, he says, look, sir, I will tell you this. I've always asked Darryl to do stuff. I've never told him to do anything. So you being his coach, you need to speak to Darryl and talk to Darryl about it. My old man told me, and I still to this day, will not speak to the man.
Jeez.
If he walks up to me, and it's between me spitting on him in the fire to put it out and him burning to death, I think he'll burn to death.
Wow.
There's no place in the game for that. The only place there is in the game for somebody to go out and do their job and do it well. And people do things that are really, really wrong. And when they do, and if nobody calls them on it, and they continue to do it. So my opinion is somebody needs to call everybody on what they're doing wrong. I mean, if I did something wrong, trust me. I have 53 guys in a coaching staff that would call me on anything that I did wrong. And if it didn't make sense, oh, Lord, did I pay the price in the locker room. If you misspoke on the radio, you got tortured when you got back to the locker room. If you did something really stupid on the field, by the time you got to the sideline, everybody was standing there looking at you on the defensive side of the ball, the offense or the special teams, looking at you going, why the hell did you do that?
Right.
That didn't make any sense. That was the
right.
kind of team I played on. Our team was the kind that was in your face and would say, hey, look, we're not going to tolerate that. We're not going to go for that. That doesn't fly in our radar. We don't deal with that. We don't have those issues. We didn't. I had a coach that looked at us and said, you know how everybody somehow tries to break it down in a race? Our coach looked at us and told us, he said, I'll tell you his name because he's a great coach and a great person. I love him to death. His name's Walt Corey. He says, look, I only got two kind of people. I go, you only got two kind of people? What kind of people are those, Walt? I got light green ones and dark green ones. I looked at him. Cornelius looked at him. He said, light green and dark green. Yeah, because every one of you in this room are making money for me. You're green people. And at that point, I just looked at it and I went, you know what? I'm playing for the right guy. And I love him to death because he would he told you the truth. He played in the league. He played with Willie Lanier, Bobby Bell, and all those great. He played on the Kansas City Chiefs team. They won the Super Bowl. I mean, he knew how to win, and he was just really, really funny. And really one of the best people I've ever been around on the football field, because if you didn't do something right, Walt will let you know.
So, Darryl, one more before we let you go. You were telling me a story about how you got Cornelius Bennett to come to Buffalo by telling him you guys actually held a practice inside a bubble.
No.
Tell that story.
Here's what I said. I said, that's what the Buffalo Bills and Bill Polian used to recruit Cornelius Bennett to come to Buffalo from Indianapolis Colts. They told him we would be practicing indoors. We had an indoor practice facility, which was a little bubble that we practiced in. But the only time we ever practiced in the bubble was when the weather was so harsh outside that offense couldn't get anything accomplished. Other than that, we practiced outside. Even when it was cold, it was snowing, we did practice outside in blizzards. And I said, yeah, Biscuit, how did you like being recruited with that recruiting tool we used to get you here? Well, Shane and I used to get a hard time about that one. He got recruited because of a bubble, and we didn't get to play in it.
That's a great story. Darryl, thank you so much for taking time out of your night to come back a second week in a row. You're a fantastic guest. We love your stories. We love having you here. We hope you'll continue to come back. We hope you'll come back from time to time.
I will do that from time to time. Whatever you guys have me.
Thank you, Darryl. We appreciate it very much. All the best to you and your family. Have a great rest of your night.
All right. Thank you.
Take it
easy, Darryl. Bye-bye.
Great stories. He's got some great stories. I'll tell you what. You know what? To me, when I was talking to Darryl off the air earlier today, I'll tell you, one of the great things would be is to sit down and have he and Jeff Harrod in a room. Listen to the two of those guys. You know, talk about their time in the league, share their stories. To me, that would be a blast.
Yeah, and he has the same demeanor and the way he tells the story sounds a lot like Jeff, so.
Yeah, he does. Yeah, indeed. All right, so let's wrap this one up. Ange, great job out of you tonight, as always. I want to give a quick shout-out to our friend Chris Carter and the Sports Geeks Radio Network, where you can find our show syndicated on their site at sportsgeeksusa.com. Next week, our lineup of guests is going to include former Giants defensive back Mark Collins. He's going to be making a third return visit here with us. We're also going to be joined by former Eagles and Browns defensive back Ray Ellis. I'm looking forward to talking to Ray.
Like I mentioned at the top, our good friend Reggie Kelly is going to be here. Reggie, a former tight end for the Bengals and the Falcons, plus owner and CEO of our sponsor, one of our key sponsors, Kyven Food. So we're looking forward to having Reggie back on the show with us. And then we're going to round it out with yet another Bills player, another former Bill. Running back Joe Burns is going to be here. I'm starting to feel like sort of the tides have completely turned. We used to be all about it. We had Steelers on every week, it seemed like, when we were first getting, you know, kicked off. And now we got Bill, and we got another Bill, and then we're going to have another Bill. All kinds of Bills lately. So good for you.
Yeah. Shane Nelson's coming back on soon.
Right?
We're circling wagons, my friend. We're circling.
Right, so it's going to be another outstanding show. So please come back and join us again next Thursday and every week. We're here from 8 to 10 p.m. On Blog Talk Radio and then on the Armed Forces Radio Network as well. I want to remind everyone how you can follow us on Twitter. I am at CT Mascaro. Ange is at FL Storms with a Z. Our friend Bob Lazzari is at Bob_Lazzari, and the show can be found at TNT Podcast. Please also check out our Facebook page and give us a like. That's important to us, too. You can stay up to date with some of our future guests on the show, and you can stream or download any of our archive episodes by checking out our website, thursdaynighttailgate.com. Again, you can find us on blogtalkradio.com. You can find our shows there. We're downloadable from iTunes. We're also now on Spreaker.com, and that is Spreaker, Spreaker.com. Also, check out our partners, our good friends over at Last Word on Sports. You can find our show on their site as well. We're a proud affiliate with those guys. Got some outstanding writers over there. If you're looking for great content across all sports, bookmark that site. That's lastwordonsports.com. And to add great flavor to any of your tailgate parties, to any party, you know, we got the holidays coming up as well, you need to stock up on plenty of Kyven Foods salsas, sauces, and spices.
Add great flavor to your next tailgate party with Kyven Salsas. Former NFL tight end Reggie Kelly created these salsas for dipping chips and much more. In hot and mild flavors, Kyven Salsas make a great marinade. They are terrific in meatloaf and are super toppers for everything from baked potatoes to scrambled eggs. It's a great ingredient to enjoy in a variety of family favorite meals. And some people say Kyven Salsa is a meal to itself. With all the possibilities, Kyven is truly salsa with soul. Kyven Salsas are also made from natural ingredients, and they are preservative-free. So look for Kyven, that's K-Y-V-A-N, at area Walmart stores or online. Click on the Kyven logo on our website to check retail and online locations. More information at Kyven82.com.
Kyven Foods, appreciate the goodness. And take us home.
And I will take us home. And if you guys out there have that favorite jersey that you purchased, or you got that autograph still sitting in the plastic in the cardboard, give our friends at Pictures Plus a call. They do great framing of sports memorabilia, artwork, pictures, or treasured memories. Their website is framedartexpert.com, and they do have a sports page where you can check out some samples, so check that out. Or you can call them at 678-468-0506. Thanks to Joe Williams of leatherheadsofthegridiron.com. So much great football content can be found on that site. And also thanks to our buddy Joe Lodge for the weekly intro. Man, he's always coming up with some creative ones. And
really
also to Kyle Turley, Tim Pickett, and all of our friends over at Gridiron Record for their partnership and the upcoming outro music. And thanks, everybody, for tuning in and downloading and all that great stuff. We appreciate it. And until next Thursday evening, good night, Kevin. Keep fighting.